He is risen. He is risen indeed. Good morning. My name is Pastor Jim Reinen, and I want to welcome you to our Easter celebration here at Mount of Olives Church in Mission Viejo. From wherever you are viewing today's service, let me direct you to our church website, moochurch.org. Through our church website, you can fill out the online communication card where you can register your attendance and let us know how you're doing. Let us know if there's anything that we can pray about for you and your family. We also encourage you through our church website to register for our daily devotions. If you'd like to have a daily devotion emailed to your house, let us know. Finally, we also want to encourage you to look on our website for opportunities to get involved at the church. Every single Sunday, we have an online church service as well as a service on campus starting today on this Easter Sunday. Pastor John Steward is beginning a series of messages called Rise Up. This will be an inspirational message of hope for you and your entire family. Thanks for being with us on this Easter as we worship together.
It's wide,
it's wide,
it's strong. your grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes me.
Let us join together as we confess our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Were you there when they nailed him? Let's join together in the prayer of the day. Almighty Father, on this most important day of the year, Easter Sunday, we are reminded that you make all things new. You have freed us from sin and death, and now we can live fully alive. Help us to live every day with the hope and joy we are experiencing today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everybody. Happy Easter. Today's reading comes to us from the book of Mark, chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early, on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they'd been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised and is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Here ends the reading. Have a blessed Easter, everyone. He is risen.
Happy Easter. I believe that Easter is the most important event in all of history. It was important because it changed the world and changed people forever. And so I want to spend some time talking about how Easter can impact our lives as well. So let me begin by asking a question. Why are you here? Why are you here? Have you ever asked yourself that question? Why am I here? Who am I? Why am I here? Viktor Frankl, the eminent psychiatrist and Holocaust survivor, wrote a book after World War II called Man's Search for Meaning. And just the title itself speaks into this idea that we need to ask this question, why am I here? It's a vital question. The answer to that question will say a lot about who we are and where we're going and what we're doing in our life. Why are we here? Only human beings can answer the question of why we're here. Your dog can't answer the question. Your cat doesn't think she needs to answer the question. And a horse doesn't answer the question. Only human beings can answer the question and should answer the question of why am I here? And so why are you here? Maybe you think you're here because of your career and your job, but yet you find that your job doesn't really add to the value and the meaning of your life. Or maybe you've become a workaholic and you see your job and your career as the place where you're going to find success and meaning, and the more you can succeed and the wealthier you can become and the more recognized and powerful, the more meaning and purpose that you're going to have. Or maybe you're just somebody who lives for themselves. How is it that you're living your life? Why are you here? Many years ago, we traveled to the Czech Republic. Terrell and I traveled with a group from Mount of Olives and some other churches to the Czech Republic and Eastern Europe as well. Dr. Callas was our tour guide, and I remember going into a castle in the Czech Republic, and it was magnificent and beautiful. And then at one point, we entered into a massive room, and the room was filled with portraits and paintings, oil paintings, of past kings and heads of state. And there were hundreds of them. I couldn't believe how many. And I stood there looking at all these paintings and all these portraits of these men with their long beards looking rather sad and looking down upon us as if they'd been drinking lemon juice. And I looked at them and I thought to myself, in their day, they were well-known, they were powerful, they had riches and fame. But now, who even knows their name? All of us gathered knew none of these people. As if they were foreign to us. We never had heard of them. We never knew anything about them. And so that can happen with fame, and yet we pursue it.
I love these events on television where somebody will interview people and show them maybe a picture of John F. Kennedy or Ronald Reagan and say, which presidents were these? And they'll say, George Washington. Or if you show somebody in their 20s and 30s a picture of a famous movie star from the 1950s like Doris Day or Clark Gable, they won't know who they are. Or just take a walk on the Hollywood Walk of Fame and look at all those stars embedded in the concrete for miles with the names of famous people on them. And yet the younger you are, the more you'll ask the question, who is this? Who are these people? You see, I bring all this up because it means that fame and riches and materialism and power are all fleeting. They evaporate. They don't give purpose and meaning to our lives. They just don't. We need something better. We need something more. Now, I think it reminds me a great deal of the time of going into a doctor's office or a dentist's office, and you're sitting in the waiting room, they've got a fish tank. And you look at the fish tank, and there's exotic fish that are swimming around, swimming in circles, chasing after each other, hoping to be looked at, and hoping somebody will feed them. But when you look at these fish in the fish tank, you realize this sometimes represents our lives. These fish have no purpose. They have no real meaning in their life. And sometimes we live our lives like this fish tank existence, and it doesn't have the kind of meaning and purpose that it's meant to have. And so I think Easter means you and I can have greater meaning and purpose in our lives. We really can. Because that's what happened to the first disciples of Jesus. When you think of the first disciples of Jesus, you realize that these were people that in the early parts of Jesus' ministry, didn't understand who he was or what he'd come to do. They didn't understand his plan. And he would tell them over and over again, and yet they still didn't understand his plan. One time, Peter tries to challenge Jesus and change his mind as to what the plan is, only to be embarrassed later on. And on it goes to where they don't understand, and they become bombastic, and they ask ridiculous questions, and they do things that kind of embarrass themselves. And then when Jesus is arrested, they become people that lack courage. They're very much afraid. They run into hiding. Peter is asked by a woman, "Did you know him?" And he denies Jesus three times. It's a picture of people that are frightened and scared and don't have any peace and are confused and are in hiding. But then, after Jesus is raised from the dead, in the days ahead, they become people of great courage and mighty warriors of faith. Now, how did that happen? How did they go from people that were afraid and running and hiding to people who had tremendous courage? There's only one explanation, and that is Jesus Christ was physically raised from the dead. He did conquer the grave, not spiritually, not philosophically, not emotionally, but he was physically and bodily raised from the dead, and they saw it, and it changed their lives forever. And now these men who used to be cowards now travel all over the world, and they tell people about the living Jesus who can save them from their sin and death. They go all around the world, and they stand up to government officials, and they stand up to religious leaders, and they are put into prison, and they are beaten, and they are tortured, and even killed for what they're proclaiming. And yet, there's a peace about them. There's a courage in their hearts. What explains this? It has to be that Jesus is really alive. They saw it with their own eyes, and they were forever changed. Friend, you and I can be changed in the same way. This is what the Bible's talking about in Romans chapter 8, verse 11, when it says these words. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you. Imagine that now. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead, when it lives in you, can give you power and strength beyond anything you've ever known, can give you purpose and meaning for your very life. The resurrection of Jesus can give us greater purpose in our lives. And that's what's available for you and for me. Now, if you're a younger person, you're probably thinking to yourself, do I really need Jesus in my life? Things are going quite well for me. I got just kind of everything I need. I got a nice car and a great place to live and great friends and a wonderful little family. Why do I need Jesus? Well, I believe that the trajectory you set on your life when you're young will determine everything about your future. I mean, think about it for a moment. With NASA and Elon Musk and SpaceX, if they fire off a rocket that's going to the moon or maybe to Mars, if they're off by 2 or 3 feet on takeoff, it really isn't probably a big deal. But by the time that rocket gets to the moon or gets to Mars, and it's off by 5,000 or 10,000 miles, it becomes a big deal. The same thing is true for our lives. Right now, you might think, I don't really need Jesus, and you might live a life without him. But you're setting the trajectory of your life. But if you'll set the trajectory of your life with the living Lord Jesus Christ, he will make sure that your path is going according to God's plan, and there will be blessing in your life and purpose in your life and meaning in your life and joy in your life. I promise. I know it's true because I've experienced it in my own life. Let Jesus be the one in control and charge of your life, and you'll be amazed at what he'll do over the trajectory of your life. Now, there's one more thing that Easter means in our life and why it's so important to the history of the world. Because not only does Easter and the reality of a risen Savior change our own hearts and lives, but it changes our eternity as well. So let me ask you a question. It's a question I often ask people all the time. If you've been coming to Mount of Olives for any length of time, you've probably heard me ask this question. And I keep asking because I find that people have a hard time understanding this. So let me ask you this question. If you were to die and stand before God, and he were to ask you, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you tell him? What would you tell him? Think about it right now. What would you say? What would you say to God that would move his heart to let you into heaven? Have you thought about it? Do you have an answer? Here's what most people tell me. They'll say things like this. Well, I've lived a pretty good life. I've tried to live a moral life. I've never intentionally hurt anybody. I've had a good job. I supported my family. I've been kind to people. I've tried to teach my children moral values and to teach them to love their neighbor as they love themselves. And compared to the people I see in the news, well, I should be in pretty good shape. But here's the problem. If you're going to get to heaven by being good, you have to be absolutely perfect. You could never have sinned, not one time. And the reason for that is because God is holy and pure and perfect. And he says, if you're going to be with me forever, you have to be perfect and pure and holy too. In fact, Jesus once said in the Sermon on the Mount, be therefore perfect as my heavenly Father is perfect. And so if you're going to get to heaven by being good, you have to have been perfect. And if you've ever broken God's commandments, well, then you're not going to make it in. But God in his great love for you and for me became a man in Jesus Christ. That's who Jesus is, God in human flesh. Jesus became a man and died on a cross, was raised again from the dead, so that those who put their trust in him would have eternal life, not because of anything good they've done, but solely and only because of what Jesus did for them at the cross. And so this is the good news for us, that because of Jesus, his shed blood, you can be washed and cleansed to stand before a holy God as if you've never sinned. Isn't that good news? You can have heaven not because of what you've done, but solely and only because of what Jesus has done for you. That's eternal life, built not on something you've done, but on what Christ has done for you. You know, there's a great example of it in a movie episode that Alfred Hitchcock produced back in 1987. It's a fictitious story about a woman who had been convicted of murder. She had been convicted of murder and sentenced to life imprisonment. And she claimed that she was going to, that she was going to escape somehow the prison cell. And so she had a plan. She looked around her circumstances and came up with a plan as to what she would do. And so what she did was she noticed there in the prison area, she noticed a man who worked for the prison. He was elderly. He was a bit frail and tired and older. He didn't have very good eyesight because of cataracts. And so she came up with a plan. Her plan was to bribe him because he was the grave digger. And he would take those who died, the inmates who died in the prison, and he would take them outside the prison walls and he would bury them. And so she said to him, I will pay you money if you'll help me escape so you can have cataract surgery. And he agreed. So here was the plan, that when the bell would toll when somebody would die, an inmate would die in the prison, that would be her signal to go down into the basement and to get into a coffin, and then he would bury her in a shallow grave and come back later and set her free. Well, she had to wait many weeks for this to happen, but finally one night she heard the toll of the bell announcing the death of an inmate. She made her way down into the basement. She got into the morgue, which was dark. She found the coffin on top of a cart, and she climbed inside along with the deceased inmate inside the coffin and shut the lid. A little while later, she could tell that the cart was being moved, and now she could feel herself being dropped down into the grave. She heard the thud. She heard the sound of the dirt piling on top of the grave and on top of the coffin, and then there was silence. There was silence for many minutes, and then an hour went by, and 2 hours went by, and several hours went by, and finally, in desperation, she lit a match to look around her circumstance, and to her horror, she was face to face with the gravedigger. Friend, that can happen to us. If we only trust in ourselves, if we only trust in what we've done for eternal life, it's like trusting in the gravedigger to set us free. We could never earn heaven. We could never earn salvation. It's a free gift that God became a man and died for in Jesus Christ. The resurrected Jesus can give you eternal life. Put your trust, your faith in him, and not in yourself, and not in the gravedigger, but in Jesus, whose plan will always work because he sealed it with his death and resurrection. Let's pray together today. Lord, we thank you for the good news of Easter. We thank you, Lord, that because Jesus lives, those who trust in him will live for eternity too, that your resurrection gives purpose and meaning to our life and gives us eternal life. Help us to embrace Christ this day in Jesus' name. Amen.
Silent and still in the dark.
Let us join together in the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
On Easter Sunday, as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, we're going to continue with that theme in a series of messages going forward called Rise Up. And just as Jesus was raised from the dead, he wants us to rise up with him and experience the abundant life and experience eternal life, peace, forgiveness, and his joy in our lives. So come and join us online in the weeks ahead, or join us for in-person worship on our campus at Mount of Olives Church in Mission Viejo, California. And now God bless you and keep you in his grace. The blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
Goodness, I would be desperate without your